Hello and a very warm welcome, viewers. You're watching the brand new edition of To The Point with your host, Kruti Mishra. And on today's show, we have a very special guest, Secretary of Department of Science and Technology, Mr. Ashutosh Sharma. Sir, welcome to Raj Sabha TV and thank you so much for joining us.
Namaskar.
Sir, let's discuss the most important issue first about oxygen. Tell us about the work which is in progress to repurpose oxygen plants, identify additional startups and industries for oxygen production and build new designs to bridge the supply and demand gap.
Indeed, oxygen is the single most important issue that one is addressing today in today's situation. Now, of course, oxygen and supply and the oxygen reaching people finally, it's a multi-dimensional problem. And so what are the major components of it? If we understand that, then we understand what kind of interventions are going on and how they are helpful for all of us. So oxygen has to be produced, it has to be supplied, it has to be effectively and efficiently used, and also the logistics of doing all of that. So these are the four major fronts on which there are, which are happening with the speed and at the scale which is required. If we just go back to the first wave of COVID-19, the maximum use of medical grade oxygen was less than 3,000 tons per day at the peak. Today we have the capability, we are producing more than 9,000 tons a day. So that certainly should take care of and address all the oxygen needs. And now having said that, there is another front which has opened up, which was not very pervasive in the first wave of COVID-19, which is the home care solutions.
Yes.
So as we know, that a whole lot of people have mild symptoms, they may have mild to moderate symptoms, and it is a whole lot of time preferable on doctor's advice to take care of this, to manage the disease at home. So therefore, we also need oxygen concentrators, which can be used at home, together with other interventions that supply oxygen. For example, different kind of more effective mask, regulation of flow rate as needed, together with devices like BiPAP and so on. So these are the different dimensions which bridge from production to the last mile connectivity of oxygen. So let me very quickly tell about how it was possible to ramp up the supply of oxygen and especially focusing on the science and technology aspects of it. So of course, the industrial supply of oxygen has always been the major component of producing oxygen. Oxygen is used in steel plants. It is used in petrochemical industries, whole lot of industries, in fact. So all of those industrial supply plants have been repurposed. In fact, as we know, that right now all the oxygen production is diverted for medical needs. And so there are two different ways that industrial supply happens, in the gaseous form, gaseous oxygen, gas oxygen, as well as liquid oxygen. For example, there are also plants all over in universities, academia, R&D labs that produce liquid nitrogen. Now, these plants can also be used by tinkering a little bit to produce liquid oxygen. And so those models and those tinkerings have come up very quickly, and many of these plants are being converted. But also industrial plants which produce liquid nitrogen as well as gas nitrogen, they are being repurposed to produce gas and liquid oxygen. So whole point is that it's great to have good infrastructure, because the basic infrastructure cannot be created overnight. And this is also true for all the repurposed science and technology that we see in play today. It basically builds on the foundations that we have created over a decade or more, both in terms of human resources, people who can do this work, as well as the basic infrastructure which is needed to be able to do that. Now, so we said that nitrogen-producing plants can be converted to oxygen production with very little additional inputs and little additional times. Similarly, you know, when we produce, let's say, gaseous nitrogen, all we need to do is replace the zeolites which are used there by a new kind of zeolites, so that material. So now, I just want to tell you very quickly, that you see, so while that looks simple, now suppose that we are not producing those zeolites in the country, which then brings us back to end-to-end solution to the problem, which means that we also need to have Atmanirbharta in producing the right kind of materials, the components. A whole lot of them were being imported before the second wave hit us. But now we understand that we need to produce a certain kind of valves, we need to produce certain kind of zeolites, we need to produce certain kind of compressors, pressure swing adsorption equipment and so on. And all of that, I'm so glad to share with you, is happening with very great speed. And thanks to the scientists who already know how to do this. Another, you know, how to make it more efficient. So there are these pressure swing absorption plants which produce oxygen, which are used in bigger settings like big hospitals and for supplying oxygen and so on. There are new variants of that which are far more efficient. They are called vacuum pressure swing and so on. All of them being tried. In terms of medium term, that we would need to develop all these materials ourselves. We would need to develop, if you want to develop oxygen concentrators, which are being largely imported right now.
Yes.
Which is fine, because when you have a crisis, clearly you have to bridge that crisis. You have to bridge the gap, and that's happening. So as we know that, you know, all kind of duties have been waived for importing these equipment. So in terms of supply lines, which we immediately need, those needs are being addressed fully. All our embassies abroad are very proactive in this. There is a whole group of government which is working on supply lines, including for the oxygen. So today, you know, within a matter of days, we are able to get these oxygen producing equipment. At the same time, even the tankers that carry oxygen, for example, are being repurposed.
Yes.
So tankers that were carrying other kind of gases have been converted to those which can carry oxygen. At the same time, there is now, in the medium term, we already started the thrust on developing these critical components in India and manufacture them. And for that, we are leveraging everybody from startups. So there is a special scheme in which startups can be funded with you know, very little time.
Yes.
So everybody has got a solution to offer in startups, in industries, in academia, and R&D, all of them working together. So in fact, there is a group of scientists and producers which are put together, you know, so you can learn much faster if you talk to each other. And so that information is very critical at this time, because we need a speed. And that speed comes only when everybody is not trying to work in silos, but they are working together to sort out problems as they move forward. I'll just give you an interesting example of innovation in oxygen. So this is developed at NAL, NAL, National Aeronautical Lab. You see, so this is basically a non-invasive ventilator, but together with the oxygen supply, because there are two different parts which are often have to be procured separately now for home use. So, you know, very interesting thing, just hydrogen peroxide solution that we have used in high school chemistry labs to produce oxygen, that can be used in a home setting. So that produces oxygen, which is then supplied through this non-invasive ventilator. And already this is going to production. So together with repurposing, together with what we already got, you know, making more of it and importing more of it, at the same time, new innovations are coming up at great speed. So that really holds the promise for our medium-term solutions. And truly to attain Atmanirbharta in this very, very important and critical dimension. So the only thing that happened here, which was different from first wave, is the speed and the intensity
yes.
of this wave,
right.
Which was not totally anticipated. And because of that, this calls for very special measures. And I'm very glad that the scientific community is matching up the expectations and the demands and the needs and priorities of the country in this matter.
So you made a very important point, and you said that we can't work in silos. We have to work together to combat this pandemic. Now, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman also made a very important statement. She said that there is no time for vaccine nationalism, and nations have to share technologies and COVID vaccines amid this pandemic. What are the efforts underway, sir?
Yes,
you
see, there are certain problems which are truly global. Now, I may add to this, for example, climate change or sustainable development. Now, climate change is not created by a single nation. Right? It cannot be addressed by a single nation. So it is fairly clear that these problems, which are of global nature, require very close cooperation. Now, imagine if somebody says, look, okay, you know, I would eradicate virus in my country, but I would leave it elsewhere. That's not going to help any country at all in the long run, because the virus doesn't care about your skin color, about the political boundaries, about nothing.
True.
Isn't it? So this is a very important lesson. In fact, India had taken the lead in this, so despite many demands, our own domestic demands, we have been helping as much as possible other nations, other countries, other societies, everywhere, because it is critical that we do that. And in fact, I think other nations have also woken up to that need in saying, look, that we need to help all those countries which at the moment are undergoing a surge. So many efforts are underway, and one of the critical issues in it, for example, vaccines. So there's a whole lot of intellectual property which is held by big companies in many countries,
yes.
Which prohibits us from making the same vaccine high speed, very quickly. Very serious efforts are underway for a temporary waiver of these intellectual properties so that the manufacturing could happen here and it can happen in time and not being very prohibitively expensive. Because every society has certain capacity to pay, and an individual and every citizen has certain capacity to pay. And so that must be totally factored in any of the products. We already know a lot of stuff which sells for $20 elsewhere might sell for $2 in India. So at the same time, the import of raw materials, it has already been allowed to a certain extent. We also supply raw material to other countries, for their needs of medical care. And we've been supplying, India has been a big supplier of generic medicines for many decades.
Yes.
So now the raw materials that is needed, for example, for vaccines are coming in. Of course, the other devices, for example, concentrators, oxygen-producing devices. Earlier, we were also getting ventilators when we had the same crisis during the first wave. We had imported many ventilators. Thankfully, now we are totally self-sufficient in the best global designs for ventilators. In fact, we have the capacity to export them. All of this happened in the first wave. The second wave, just being a little bit different in terms of its speed and its peak value, has made new challenges. But no matter what the challenges are, we are totally committed as a community, as government, as industry, as startups, all of them, R&D labs, academia, all of them have the shared purpose. So just as we were able to overcome in the first wave, I haven't any doubt that while we see the impact of crisis now, totally understand that. I get hundreds of phone calls every day,
yes,
that require help. I totally understand that, but I haven't any doubt that in a short time we would overcome many of these crisis situations because of the interventions we are being put there now.
Absolutely, sir. We're just hoping for that. But since the onslaught of this pandemic, since the first wave, we've been working on mathematical calculations and models. Now, what do the mathematical models indicate now about the peak of the second wave and the decline of this wave?
Yes, that's a very good question. So first of all, because there is no very common understanding of what a mathematical model means and what it does not mean. What are our expectations? Why do we need mathematical models? So mathematical model, first of all, let me say, is not a crystal ball. It does not predict the future. because if there was such a thing, if we all knew what the future is mathematically, we would require very little else. It is not a Janampadri. Okay, not that I believe in Janampadri totally, but all I'm saying is not a crystal ball.
Yes.
So what is a mathematical model? Mathematical model basically tells you, well, how do people interact, how the infection goes from one person to another, and what is the rate of that? So if we knew the behavior of virus, and if we knew the behavior of people, and the interaction between virus and the people, and for example, mobility of people, and basically what kind of precautions they are taking, then you are able to reasonably well predict what the outcome of all of this would be. Now the critical point is that all these inputs that go into mathematical modeling, these inputs which I said, behavior of virus, for example, if mutations happen, they again have to be factored in the model. If if people are not wearing masks, that has to be factored in. Thinking of masks, by the way, I'm not wearing masks, but I absolutely must say that wearing two masks today is very essential, or one N95 mask. The only reason I'm not wearing it, because my office is out of bounds for all physical meetings, totally.
Yes.
And there is a great deal of exhaust. So most important thing I would like to point out here, no matter we are in first wave, second wave, third wave, no matter what, we absolutely have to observe COVID-19 appropriate behavior.
Yes.
And we'll probably discuss a little bit of that later.
Yes.
Mutation or no mutation, doesn't matter. It matters. But I'm saying in terms of our actionable items,
yes,
for each one of us, it is absolutely necessary that we must not forget that we don't let virus transmit. And to prevent that transmission, all the protocols that have been invoked have to be totally continued even more strongly now than ever before.
Right.
So we were saying about the mathematical model.
Yes, sir.
Model. So it had correctly predicted the waning of the first wave. At the time, we saw that there were smaller numbers. They were going small. Okay. But like I pointed out, unless you factor in the change in people's behavior or the mutations of the virus and the mobility of people, the mixing of people and so on. So all of these things actually changed, right? So once they changed, the model predictions also start changing. A good model, basically, if the inputs remain the same, then it's able to predict the future, let's say for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, something like that. And then as things change, on the ground, the model predictions also have to be adjusted accordingly. So now, having said all that, so one should perfectly understand that that's basically what mathematical models are. No mathematical model globally have been 100% successful. So because it's not a crystal ball, right? Predicting something, but based on everything that happens on the ground. Okay. So now, of course, the predictions of us, there are many, many different mathematical models. First of all, I should say, in fact, the Department of Science and Technology during the beginning of the first wave commissioned 38 different mathematical groups to come up with mathematical models. 38, okay, because we don't know which one is going to evolve in a good shape, which one is going to be robust. And all of that is judged by the scientific community, right? So every time a scientist does something, how good that is judged by the scientific community. There are several models, but of course, many of them now predict that, as we know, that the peak values of the kind that we see now, they predict that we are nearly at the peak now. Okay. I must, however, repeat that this is not government's position. Okay. So
yes.
Because this is scientific, right? So while the government takes inputs from many different models and inputs from many different other knowledge streams, right? And you have to rely, you have to make a composite picture out of all of that to see what interventions are needed, what kind of planning is needed, and so on. So one of the models that I'm quoting here well, basically says that we are nearly at the peak now, and then slow decline from there.
Okay.
You know, so once you hit a peak, it takes a bit of time for things to change.
Hmm.
Why does that happen? Because what happened 2 weeks ago actually affects us today.
Exactly.
You know, so today is the tomorrow of yesterday, so to say. And so what, it's not what I do now today is going to change scenario. Okay, but what happened 2 weeks earlier, what happened a week earlier,
hmm.
all of that cumulatively, you know, reflects in what is happening now. So we should start seeing changes in a week, in 2 weeks from now.
Okay.
Okay, and so most important thing is hold our fort, do everything which is important, necessary for us to address this wave. And so this is about mathematical models. And in fact, when the virus hit us, the nation had no capacity, no scientists working this very important area.
Yes.
So now what we are doing is that we are making this a more permanent feature, which means funding the different groups that have the capacity to work in this area on a continuous basis. So it's not like when the virus disappears that this activity stops. So like I said, that you cannot do things overnight. And so we should have a deep foundation, a strong foundation to build on every time there's a crisis. And so that we are now setting up centers, setting up groups, which will continue to work in this important area and will be on top of all the knowledge which is required in the area whenever there's a need in the future.
Absolutely, sir. Since we're talking about future developments, another important aspect that I'd like to touch upon and take your opinion is on clinical trials for vaccines on children. What is your take, Mr. Sharma?
So those vaccines are developing. Right now, we don't have a vaccine for children.
Yes.
But certainly, because, and especially in India, because India has demographic dividend, which means we are a nation of young population.
Mm.
So those things are happening. As we know, that developing right kind of vaccine is a time-consuming process. It used to take, in good old days, anywhere 10 years or longer to develop a vaccine. Just to put things in perspective, you know, because many people may not realize that vaccine development is a very time-intensive process historically. And that now we have been able to do it. Even one of the vaccines that developed in India, right, it developed with very great speed, you know, which is unprecedented in the area of developing vaccines. So I haven't any doubt that, you know, the new vaccine for children would also be on its way. It is being done globally and efforts also on in India to do that.
Okay, sir. Lastly, I'd just like to understand, what is your ministry, your department doing in order to address the research and development and innovation related challenges that this pandemic has thrown in front of us?
Yes, so again, this is very multidimensional. So when you look at things like diagnostics, you have to look at things like ventilators, then you have to look at, of course, vaccine development, and now oxygen problem. So there are a whole lot of different things which have happened, and who are the stakeholders who would actually do it? So we work with, we support a large number of stakeholders of different nature. So these are startups. We do a mapping of all the startups and say, look, which one of them can deliver very quickly, which one of them can deliver in medium term, and so on. And then, of course, even industries which are prepared for scale up or have a good design and want to go into production. There is an arm of DST called Technology Development Board, which is to commercialize indigenous technology. So they support these kind of efforts. And so what is happening? So let's look at one of them, diagnostics.
Mm-hmm.
What we need in terms of diagnostics today, because one needs to do more tests, one needs
yes.
to do more rapid tests. So a whole lot of new techniques, more than 30 of them have developed indigenously during this period. For rapid screening through antibodies and antigens, and they have attained very high accuracies. So all of them are being now used, pressed in the service of rapid testing. Many of them came from IITs, many of them came from startups, industry, and so on. And all of them have been empowered. They have all been supported, both through knowledge resources and financial resources for them to be able to do it.
Right.
Then if you look at RT-PCR, there have been a lot of reforms there. There is a very recent development coming from CSIR, which is, when it takes swab samples, then they are put in a saline, which explodes these viruses, releases RNA, and then transport it. Instead of doing all of that, which is a very time-consuming process, preparing the sample is a time-consuming
yes.
process, and not just the RT-PCR test itself. So that is being replaced by, dry samples, dry swab samples. That's a very good innovation, which would cut down on the overall
yes.
time for
yes.
testing, produce rapid results. Easy to assemble hospitals. These have been developed, and in fact, they have been put together in many different places when you want to create a new hospital rapidly. Also, very good designs for that have been made. New designs for ventilators, which are driven by artificial intelligence, which can be used with telemedicine, because we know that sometimes there would be a shortage of trained medical practitioners,
yes.
Which are
yeah.
required for invasive ventilators. So if we have designs which can be monitored, in parallel by one doctor, 10 of them, for example. So all of these new technology elements are being built into all of this. Then in terms of virus behavior, see, it's very critical, medium term, long term, all these mutations happening.
Yes.
We need to understand what these mutations are doing. And for that, we need facilities which are called biosafety level 3 and 4. Which are very few in the country.
Right.
So
right.
these 10 new facilities have been being set up with our help, where you can study the behavior of virus, but in safe environment,
okay.
Which means, this is why it's called biosafety level high level 3 and 4, where you can even deal with live viruses without you getting infected by it.
Okay.
So all these facilities are very critical in order to now seed in projects which would look at the behavior of virus. Whole lot of these studies have been already funded, even the first wave of virus.
Yes.
But we
yes.
must remember that the basic science studies, they take a little bit longer than technology.
True.
Okay, so science is a little long term and it is global. And our technology issues, which are now become very critical, have to be first sorted out with greater speed. Innovations are happening. For example, just to conclude, I don't know how much time we have, but I will just give you two very compelling examples of
yes.
innovations. So in oxygen, because we have been discussing oxygen a lot, now you realize that in a continuous oxygen supply machine, when you inhale, oxygen goes in, but when you exhale, okay,
yes.
oxygen is not going in, it's going out.
Right.
Okay, so it's a waste. So 50% of the time, your oxygen is going waste, right? So imagine if we were to have a device which regulates this. So when you're exhaling, you don't have to supply oxygen because it's just going out, doing
yes.
nothing. So just this little technology intervention can increase the supply, imagine, by 50%.
Okay.
Isn't it? Because half the time you're inhaling, half
yes.
the time you're
yes.
exhaling. And when you're exhaling, all the oxygen which is just going out, isn't it? So very simple concept to understand, and we are now making prototypes of those devices which might make it possible. So even without changing any production, this is about repurposing the use, more efficient use of oxygen. Another intervention, for example, is we take oximeter readings that tells us how much oxygen is needed. If we couple this monitoring of oxygen level with supply of oxygen, then we are not wasting oxygen.
Yes.
Right? So if you're right, it must be based on good demand, not just, okay, just throw everything away, whether demand is there or not. Right? So these are very simple concepts, and we are translating them in terms of technology, by getting scientists involved in this process, by getting labs involved in this process. So all of this happening, very, very good innovations are actually going on. And I haven't any doubt that very soon we should have Atmanirbharta in these dimensions which have been thrown at us, at very unprecedented speed. And our speed
sir.
And our resolve must match all the challenges which are in front of us.
So we do hope that with these innovations, we are able to fight and, more importantly, defeat this pandemic. Mr. Sharma, you joined us on To The Point Show. Thank you so much for speaking to us and giving us those important insights.
Thank you so much. Stay safe.
Thank you, sir.